Welcome to this video. So we are doing right now a meter transfer, electrical meter name transfer from previous owner to the new owner. So make sure that the prerequisite for your electrical meter transfer would be to get your contract transferred first under your name in Bangalore, and then you pay up your all your tax dues that are there for that particular financial year, and then you are ready to do your electrical meter name transfer. Make this clear, this is only applicable to first electrical entity, that is DESCOM. Next is, this is without bribe or broker. Bribe or broker. So if you want to get this done through a broker or a bribe, so basically an agent, so you can get it done. That will save all this hassle for you. Next is, let's go about whether did we go about doing it online or offline. We went with an offline process. So in offline process, what happens? You prepare the list of documents, you walk into their office, await a little bit of time there, and then the person would be the engineer, junior engineer, or whoever it is. He will be available. Get that done, and then walk into a main branch office, which will be there for a reason. So you go there, and then they will be available. So get that done. So we went on weekend, that is on Saturday, and we got it done. Even then, there wasn't a crowd at all. So I mean, at least in weekdays, you can expect even a little lesser crowd. So that how quick was an offline process for us. In an online process, what happens is that when you submit, and then you have to multiple times do a follow-up by calling the customer care, the DESCOM customer care, and all that. So that we thought that we will not get into that hassle of doing it online. We went through the offline process. It took us a half a day process, not even one day process, and half a day process. I'll let you know what will be the timings of these branches and all this, and then I feel get this done, and then you are done with your name transfers. So whatever that I will be explaining you, that will be on an offline process. So that first, next is that. So next, let's go about what are the documents that we need in the part one. First is a photocopy of a ownership document. So let's say ownership document. Pardon my writing skills. So ownership documents. So ownership documents would be basically a sale deed for most of the situations, or it might be a gift deed if you have got it. The sale deed executed in terms of a gift, or it's a partition deed if it was owned by somebody else, and then it was a joint venture, and then you got the entire ownership now. So whatever the case, so let's say it's a sale deed. So you have to have this sale deed ready. So sale deed, the one of the prerequisite for the sale deed is make sure that it is attested from a gazetted officer. It is very mandatory that you have to get it attested, or your next office, which is your local branch office, will not agree to this. Just what we did was, we went into sub-register office. You'll get to know in the next set of documents for which I have made use of sub-register office itself. So go to your sub-register office, get to an advocate. He will do the needful for you. You pay him like 100 rupees or something like that. So first cost for you would be the 100 rupees for getting this sale deed attested. So you can go to a sub-register office, walk into an advocate, pay 100 rupees, and get it done. So at an end of the day, you should have your sale deed attested. That's the first prerequisite document to prove your ownership, that you are the owner of this particular premises. Next is recent tax paid receipt. So now, as I have said it before, in order to have the receipt of tax paid, first, very important, and one of the prerequisite of meter transfer is you have to have your khata under your name. It should be in the term status. So there is a separate video, you can have a look about that. So now coming to this tax paid stuff. So you go, you might have paid it on a physically walking into a Bangalore one, and you would have got a receipt, that receipt. Or you might have made it an online payment, and you see that you can download that receipt. Basically, in that tax paid receipt, what is that they verify is your name and is your address. Name and your address. So that is what the tax paid receipt should be. So it also verifies that that the khata has been transferred under your name, and then you are liable to pay the tax for that particular premises. So that is the second ownership document that you should be having. So there is no other prerequisite. So make your khata done, pay all the dues of your tax for that particular unit, and then you will have your tax paid receipt with you. Next is ID proof. So ID proof, any proof, a local ID proof like voter ID, starting with voter ID or a passport or Aadhaar card. So basically now everything works with an Aadhaar card. So what you do is you take an unmasked, make sure that it is unmasked and get another card. So there is no need of attesting or anything as such. Only one that need to be attested is this ownership document so far. Taxpayer need not be, or this ID proof need not be. Get your convenient ID proof. I took with an Aadhaar card, so it worked out for me. So next step would be a NOC. This is a very important document which you have to get it from the previous builder if the flat was purchased with the help of a builder, or it need to be taken by the previous owner if the ownership has been transferred to you. So we took a builder one, NOC. That NOC format is again available on the link that I'm gonna provide to you. And also the ownership document looks the NOC looks as similar to this one, so you can have a look at this. I'll walk you through this application form, but as of now the NOC to be taken, so here it is. So so you see that the transfer of installation, I'm at the right page. So you see the transfer of installation with deposit. It says that the property bearing the address, your address here, not it is not a basic address here. It is like survey number, serial number and all this. You can get this template as an example on online as well. So that will be, for an example, it will be some way related to like this. So this survey number 143-193-47 site number, that will be going here. That you can see that in the your electricity bill, and it has to say that is sold by me to your owner, your name basically, and I give my consent to transfer the installation along with the deposit. So he has to sign with this seal and signature. Make sure that he signs it and also puts his the seal as well. And then whatever, his name, address and date and when it is being done. You leave this bank as of now. The subdivision for particular, they will fill it up when you walk into that assistant executive office, right? It is called as an AO office. So they will fill this subdivision, and you can keep the date as an open date because you don't know when it might be, when you might be going about doing this. So get this NOC signed from your previous owner. In my case, it was a builder. He signed and he also put a signature. He also sealed it. So that is all about NOC. Get this important document ready. So basically, this is saying that the obligation, there is no obligation from the builder or the previous owner who owns the meter or who has procured the meter to be transferred along with the deposit, to be transferred under your name as a new owner. So that is what the NOC is for. Let's go to the next important document, which is your photo. Make sure you carry a passport size photo. It's a passport size photo. It shouldn't be hard for you to fetch it. So next, let's you have to make sure that there is you have paid. You have to take the latest electrical bill copy, and you should have paid all the dues there. There will be a present current bill months, present bill month, as well as the arrears, whichever that is there. So make sure that the total payable amount for you would be zero. If you log into their website, so clear all your bills and then walk in, and then also take this latest electrical bill copy. Either get that Xeroxed or take the original itself if you don't need it, because you will always have that audit on your online platforms. So that is that. Next important document would be your meter board copy. What do I mean by that? So make sure that you go to your meter board and then take a snap of that. Where the readings are clearly shown, the readings should be shown, one that prerequisite. Second would be there will be some numbers that will be present on that particular meter board. Make sure that those numbers are visible. Take it an HD kind of a snap, and then you have to print it. You have to print that image, whichever that you have taken. So basically, it's a meter photocopy that you have to take it. So and then make sure that there is a reading that is being displayed, and then take that meter copy. Take it as an image. Next would be one of the important documents, that is your application form. So since we are establishing that we are going offline and it is a quicker process and we can get it done within a half day, so application form, we have to take a printout of that application form and then get that filled. We will get to the filling of the application form later on, but make sure that you have to take the form 13. The form 13 is basically for name transfer. I'll show you the form 13 now, but don't take the form 1. Form 1 is for different person. I'll also show you the form 1. I mistakenly took a form 1 printout, and I don't use it right now. So form 13 is what you should be taking. and we will walk through the form 13 process, how to fill it, in the next set of video. But as of now, you take the form 13 video, form 13 application. So this is form 13, as you see it here. So you can get this form 13, do a generic Google search, and then you will get it, form 13. And if possible, I'll also try to put it in a description. But this is how the form 13 looks. So basically, it says the transfer of installation. So all our basic details, but however, I will cover this in the later section of the video. So you will have all these documents. So form 13, and one more important thing that it will be having is all that, all the other official memorandum and all that. It will also have the format of how you have to get the NOC and all that. And it will also say you the next important step of document, that is an agreement, that's a power supply agreement. That will be a three page, I think so. Yeah. So this is an agreement which you have to get it done. I'll walk you through the next process. And the next is indemnity bond. So all this would be there in a form 13. So you need not get the entire form 13 copy. You have to get the first two. Only the first two pages are very important. This is what will be signed by the officer, the junior engineer over there in your local branch. Only first two are important. These are informations. You need not take this printout, but I have taken it, however. So the important form 13 that you have to take is the first two pages of it. So now this is what you are supposed to be taking. Then there is one more thing called as a format 1. So you can ignore this totally. So this is for, as you see, that requisition for supply of energy. So as if that you are taking a new meter, and then you are requesting your BESCOM office to supply the power. So that is what, I mean, this is basically for, as I understand, for the new connections, that which will be taken by the builder or your previous landowners who has constructed the building over there, whatnot. So you shouldn't be taking this. That's what I'm trying to express. So form 1 is no for this name transfer. You have to get this form 13. So that's one of the important documents that you have to take. Next important document would be your first one is power supply agreement. Power supply agreement. So power supply agreement, we'll walk through this. And the second one would be indemnity bond. See, basically the power supply agreement says that there is an agreement between you and the electrical entity, that is BESCOM. The first party would be that, and second party would be you. That we are getting into an agreement that you would supply power to us, right? So that need to be notarized somewhere, as with any agreement, since it's a legal thing, right? So you have to get it notarized first. Walk into your notarized centers, local notarized centers. I'll let you know where I got that done. So that is what the power supply agreement will be saying, and then you have to get it notarized. So next would be indemnity bond. Indemnity bond says that you are liable to that electrical equipment that has been installed on your premises. Since there is a name transfer right now, so that makes completely sense, right? Because you have been, there is a person X who owned the premises, and then he had entered into a bond with the electrical department. Now that ownership has been transferred to Y, that is a new owner for you. So now this new owner have to enter into a agreement that if there is basic damage onto that meter board or whatever that the electrical supply unit or an electrical equipment, if it goes for a damage, you are liable to pay the penalty for that. So that is what the indemnity bond says. So this is what the context is. Now, where to get this done? So let's go with the power supply agreement. The easiest and the quickest way to get it done would be your sub-register office. So go to your sub-register. I mean, it's not done exactly in the sub-register's office. Yeah, if you go walk into any sub-register's office, right? So there will be lot of logistic attached to that, right? I mean, basically what I'm saying is there are a lot of Xerox centers, e-stamp centers. That is what important is, e-stamp centers. And you will be having the notary centers where an advocate will be sitting over there, a lawyer, advocate centers. So because that's work, all that related work will be happening in the sub-register. So all this there will be a shops outlet over there. So if you go to any sub-register, not the office, the sub-register premises, there you will find the e-stamp and the notary. So now that is what required for us. So that's a hack here. So in the past, in order to get this power supply agreement printed, so you have to go to any nearby Xerox. You have to first get the e-stamp for that. So take a 200 rupees e-stamp paper. So you have to basically pay the 200 rupees and whatever the GST and the processing fees of that particular paper would be. So in the e-stamp there should be a 200 rupees value. So take that, and then the content, as I told you before, right? The content is over here. So let me show that to you. So you see this power supply agreement for supply of low tension electrical energy. So this is the entire content. You see that there is a 3 page, I think so, if I'm correct. So this is 3 page. So you have to get this. You see that your customer signature and then one witness. Make sure any witness over there or your relative get it signed. This would be for the official purpose. Don't use this. So you have to put this on that e-stamp. So the e-stamp should clearly say in the subject the power supply agreement. Make sure that in the subject it doesn't simply say agreement. Make sure that it says power supply agreement. Put that in a bond, in a e-stamp bond, and print this content. It says an agreement made this. You have to write the present day when you are submitting this file. You have to keep it open or make sure that you write it on your own. And it says that between what electrical supply company and your name. So you have to make that over there and your address. So make sure that if the bond has been printed over like this and you put this over content over here, all the rest of the content should come on the back of the page. And the rest content will be spilled over to a normal pages, like a normal A4 sheet pages. And that will be at the end, you will be having this all the signature. So that is how you prepare a power supply agreement. So now coming to the other stuff, that is indemnity bond. So as I told, why the indemnity bond is needed. So I'll let you know what the content of an indemnity bond is. So all this is there in the application, that the Form 13 which I told you. Need not take this, but if you have the content ready, might as well. So indemnity bond. What does the indemnity bond says? It has the RR number and the same way. So take an indemnity bond of 200 rupees again. You have to take a e-stamp basically. So in that e-stamp, the subject should be an indemnity bond, the procurement of it, and you have to pay 200 rupees. Make sure that the value of the e-stamp is 200 rupees, and whatever the processing cost of that would be, 200 rupees plus GST plus printout costs and whatever. So on the stamp, you will be having the subject as indemnity bond and 200 rupees as the value, and on that, the first content of this, if again in the similar way, right? E-stamp will be having the entire content over here, and in the bottom of that, there will be a simple blank page. On that, you write this content. You make sure that this content is over here, and you have to fill in what Shri. You have to say your name, aged about, what your age, and number. Bind myself to an indemnity of electricity of this particular legal entity. So all this content. This is a simple. If you go through what need to be written, what need to be written, you will understand of what it is. Or else you can take on the help of your assistant engineer, who in the later in the stages you will get to know. They will also help you. So whatever that you know, you fill it up. Make sure that the very important stuff is your age, your name, and the RR number and the address. That's it. So one important thing while you make the indemnity bond would be the rest of the content should be compulsorily on the back of the page. Let's say the stamp is like this. The stamp will be coming till here, and the blank space you will be having the first paragraph here, and the rest of the paragraph should be on the back of the page. It should be a one document. Only your power supply agreement will be a multiple page, but then indemnity bond will be basically a one page only. And then you have to write your name, signature, and sign it. That would be done. So that is indemnity bond. Once you have that indemnity bond ready, right? So now you have your power supply agreement ready and indemnity bond ready on each 200 e-stamp paper. So now what you have to do? So the agreement is ready right now. So you have to get it notarized. So that's where. So the next entity that you will be contacting is your advocate or a notary, who would be holding a green pen. He can also do an attestation. So it is better that it's better that if you have your sale deed, right? Sale deed is not attested, let's say. So you can get your sale deed, you can get your power supply agreement ready, indemnity bond ready. Walk into a notary or an advocate, get all these three notarized or even attested. For that matter, notary will do attestation, and even if you need to do the notary for this, he will also do the sale deed notarization and attestation. But for power supply agreement and the indemnity bond, it is mandatory to get it notarized because these are agreements. So once you walk into an advocate, he does all this magic with a green pen, and then he will have a seal and signature saying that I have notarized this on so and so date, and they have sworn in front of me. That's the end of your agreements. So that's overall. Also there you have to pay an advocate a notarized fee of 100 to ranging how you bargain with that particular person. So 100 to somewhere around 300, because he is notarizing three documents for you. So 100 to 300 rupees, that's what I paid. So I'll let you know the cost at the end of the video of what how much a legal fees would cost for you to get all this process done, and also including the wait for it, including what you say, including the registration fees and all that, the transfer fees and all that at the end of the video. So I'll stay tuned for that. So that's all about the list of documents. There is one more document. If the ownership is in the joint name, let's say you and your wife or you and your siblings own a what do you say, premises on a joint holding basis. If it is on a single owner, then that's fine. All you need not get this next process. If it is on a joint ownership, you have to make sure that both of these guys, like both of these person or any number of owners that are there holding the premises, should be present during the notary, even the notarizing process. If the advocate has all authority to question who is the other person whom he has not come or she has not come, so he might question you on that basis. So make sure that the other people are present along with you. So that is one. And the other person who would ask you is that executive electrical engineer when you go to that particular office. So you need to be present during the application verification process. Your two photocopies of both of the owners should be present over there. If not, then you can take the NOC from the other owner. And then make that document ready. NOC, getting an NOC for what do you say, the name transfer is easily available on a Google search. You can just search that and then get that ready. It should be as similar to the NOC which you got from the builder. It should be similar to that. But this is another document if it is on a joint owner basis. So I think I have covered all the forms that you basically need